Hello, welcome to our classes. I am Dr. K.K. Mishra. In this video tutorial, I would be covering theoretical aspect of Companies Act 2013 Part 2. Let me tell you that this Part 2 is in series of my earlier video tutorial that was about company and its type in that was covered in Part 1. In this Part 2 of this theoretical view of Companies Act 2013, which highlights only the key changes which have been brought into this act from Companies Act 1956. Here I would be covering auditing aspect, audit and auditors in detail. Companies Act 2013, auditor and auditors, that is the title basically of this video tutorial. Mandatory auditor, rotation and joint auditors, the term introduced. The 2013 Act now mandates the rotation of auditors after the specified time period. The 2013 Act also includes an enabling provision for joint audits. Non-audit services. The 2013 Act now states that any services to be rendered by the auditor should be approved by the board of directors or the audit committee. Additionally, the auditor is restricted from providing certain specific services. Let me tell you that as earlier I spoke that I would just be covering only key highlights which have been brought into this new Act 2013, not the entire statements or the laws and sections of the Act. Auditing standards. The standards on auditing have been accorded legal sanctity in the 2013 Act and would be subject to notification by the NFRA. Auditors are now mandatorily bound by the 2013 Act to ensure compliance with standards on auditing. Cognizance to Indian accounting standards. In short, in AS. The 2013 Act in several sections has given cognizance to the Indian accounting standards, which are standards conversed with international financial reporting standards in view of their becoming applicable in future. For example, the definition of a financial statement includes a statement of changes in equity which would be required under Indian Accounting Standards Section 2, Class 40 of Companies Act 2013. Secretarial audit for bigger companies. In respect of listed companies and other class of companies, as may be prescribed, the Companies Act 2013 provides for a mandatory requirement to have secretarial audit. The draft rules make it applicable to every public company with paid-up share capital of rupees 100 crores. This is highlighted fact that one should keep in mind. As specified in the 2013 Act, such companies would be required to annex a secretarial audit report given by a company secretary in practice with its board's report. The detail of it is given in Section 204 of Companies Act 2013. Now, secretarial standards. The 2013 Act requires every company to observe secretarial standards specified by the Institute of Company Secretaries of India with respect to general and board meetings. The detail of it is given in Section 118, Clause 10 of Companies Act 2013, which were hitherto not given cognizance under the 1956 Act. Internal audit. The importance of internal audit has been well acknowledged in companies. Auditor Report Order 2003, the order pursuant to which auditor of a company is required to comment on the fact that the internal audit system of the company is commensurate with the nature and size of the company's operations. However, the order did not mandate that an internal audit should be conducted by the internal auditor of the company. The order acknowledged that an internal audit can be conducted by an individual who is not in appointment by the company. The 2013 Act now moves a step forward and mandates the appointment of an internal auditor who shall either be a chartered accountant or a cost accountant or such other professional as may be decided by the board to conduct internal audit of the functions and activities of the company. The class or classes of companies which shall be required to mandatorily appoint an internal auditor as per the draft rules are as follows. Every listed company, every public company having paid up share capital of more than 10 crores of rupees, every other public company which has any outstanding loans or borrowings from banks or public financial institutions more than 25 crore rupees, or which has accepted deposits of more than 25 crore rupees at any point of time during the last financial year. Audit of items of cost. The central government may, by order, in respect of such class of companies engaged in the production of such goods or providing such services as may be prescribed, direct that particulars relating to the utilization of material or labor or to other items of cost may be prescribed shall also be included in the books of account kept by that class of companies. By virtue of this section of the Companies Act 2013, the cost audit would be mandated for certain companies. Section 148 of Companies Act 2013 clearly explains this particular aspect of the change which has been brought. It is pertinent to note that similar requirements have recently been notified by the central government. Now, regulators. National Company Law Tribunal, in short NCLT, in accordance with the Supreme Court's judgment on 11 May 2010 on the composition and constitution of the tribunal, modifications relating to qualification and experience etc. of the members of the tribunal has been made. Appeals from the tribunal shall lie with the NCLT. Chapter 17th of the 27 of the 2013 Act, consisting of section 407 to 434, deals with NCLT and appellate tribunal. National Financial Reporting Authority, NFRA, this is the acronym for it. I mean, one should remember it. That is National Financial Reporting Authority. The 2013 Act requires the constitution of NFRA, which has been bestowed with significant powers not only in issuing the authoritative pronouncements but also in regulating the audit profession. Serious Fraud Investigation Office, SFIO. The 2013 Act has bestowed with legal status to SFIO. Now, mergers and acquisitions. The 2013 Act has streamlined as well as introduced concepts such as reverse mergers, merger of foreign companies with Indian companies, and squeeze out provisions which are significant. The 2013 Act has also introduced the requirement for valuations in several cases, including mergers and acquisitions by registered valuers. Corporate social responsibility. The 2013 Act makes an effort to introduce the culture of corporate social responsibility, popularly known as CSR, in Indian corporates by requiring companies to formulate a corporate social responsibility policy and at least incur a given minimum expenditure on social activities. Class action suits. The 2013 Act introduces a new concept of class action suits, which can be initiated by shareholders against the company and auditors. Now, prohibition of association or partnership of persons exceeding certain number. The 2013 Act puts a restriction on the number of partners that can be admitted to a partnership at 100. To be specific, the 2013 Act states that no association or partnership consisting of more than the given number of persons as may be prescribed shall be formed for the purpose of carrying on any business that has for its object the acquisition of gain by the association or partnership or by the individual members thereof, unless It is registered as a company under this 1956 Act or is formed under any other law for the time being in force. As an exception, the aforesaid restriction would not apply to the following: a Hindu undivided family carrying on any business, an association or partnership if it is formed by professionals who are governed by special acts like Chartered Accountants Act, etc. This is given in section 464 of Companies Act 2013. Power to remove difficulties. The central government will have the power to exempt or modify provisions of the 2013 Act for a class or classes of companies in public interest. Relevant notification shall be required to be laid in draft form in Parliament for a period of 30 days. The 2013 Act further states no such order shall be made after the expiry of a period of 5 years from the date of commencement of Section 1 of the 2013 Act. The detail of it is given in Section 470 of 2013 Act. Insider trading and prohibition on forward dealings. The 2013 Act for the first time defines insider trading and price sensitive information and prohibits any person, including the director or key managerial person, from entering into insider trading. The detail of it is given in Section 195 of Companies Act 2013. Further, the Act also prohibits directors and key managerial personnel from forward dealings in the company or its holding, subsidiary or associate company. This is given in detail in Section 194 of Companies Act 2013. So this was all about this particular aspect of auditors or auditing in detail, and detail of the highlighted, not detail in total. I hope that you have understood and liked it. If you have liked it, please do not forget to subscribe my channel R Classes and press the bell button and pass on to others, those who are needy now and in the future. Please like, share and subscribe. Thank you very much. Have a nice time. Best of luck.